Is it okay to like take a sip of coffee or
sip,
no?
You can leave if you need to.
Okay.
If Phil needs to bounce around. You didn't really feel like an artist?
No, don't
feel like an artist?
I mean, I think now I've gotten used to that, and I do feel like one now, but I didn't for many years. I think it was just because I did not have the confidence to kind of see myself that way. But Frank, my husband, did, and he always really supported that. So I think at some point I started believing that too.
So what made you think photography as a profession was a legitimate option for you?
I actually did not want to be a photographer. I went to Harvard not planning on studying photography, and I studied social studies, and which at Harvard is economics and anthropology and sociology. And in a weird way, a lot of those things came in to inform my work. But midway through, I realized that the theoretical wasn't for me, and that I wanted to look at sociology, look at people, but on the street with people. And so I started doing photography there. But I didn't think it was a job. And so everything I did, it was going to be my last project. Mm-hmm. And I did what I thought was going to be my last project after school. And then I applied for a job at ABC News and went there and realized I wasn't a jobber like that. And I ended up getting an internship at National Geographic. And that was really where my photo career started.
So when you got there as an intern, do you shoot things or do you just kind of help out?
It's a really extraordinary internship. You do get to shoot. You also look through film of people in the field where you learn a ton, like seeing how they shoot. Mm-hmm. But you also get to play with any of the toys there. Like they have a equipment closet and you can check out any camera you want. And that was the time of film. And they had old film that had been in the field that they didn't want to send back to the field because it could have been heat damaged or whatever, but the interns could just shoot as much of it as they wanted. And then the most important part was they looked at your work. So you had kind of the greatest photo editors in the world giving you feedback. So for me, it was 3 months, but it was like grad school.
Was there anything that kind of, any particular thing that clicked with you there where somebody said, well, this is what you're all about, or this is what, you know, your focus should be, or anything?
Yeah. I went to, so when you finish your story there, you have to give a presentation of your, they call it a tray. It's the slides in a tray. At that time, it was slide projection.
Good old days.
Which you see in my film, Generation Wealth, but it hasn't been around for a while. And
now it's kitsch.
This photographer, Jody Cobb, did one. And each picture, she had to explain how it fit into the story. Mm-hmm. And that's really what I learned at National Geographic, is that it was the first place I saw the photographer making the story, not just illustrating what a writer was doing, but really doing the research, making the story, and having to justify each picture. There wasn't any room for a pretty picture. Each picture had to tell the story in a meaningful way.
So did you have a style? How invasive a photographer were you as you were starting out, as you were doing the first thing?
I think I started out much more fly on the wall. Black and white, no flash, one camera, one lens. When I went to the Geographic, I learned color. Color has to be a little bit more intrusive because fill flash becomes an important part of the story or of getting the pictures. And so I started using flash and learning how to do that. And then you still can be pretty small with photo. So it was still a huge leap when I made my first film thin and all of a sudden had a crew. I mean, we were a small crew. I think we were four women in that, but it was much bigger than just being alone as a photographer and then eventually working with one assistant.
So how did that come together? Was that something you were interested in, or was it something that presented itself somehow?
Film?
Thin.
Oh, thin, yeah. So I had always been interested in film. I studied film and anthropology in college. I studied film in college. And I applied to all these film schools and got rejected by every single one. And so I did my photography. My husband said, do your photography. If you do that, you know, you'll be able to do other things later. And I did a book called Girl Culture. And that was like a 5-year project. And it was kind of my first success. It went into several printings. Mm-hmm. And with that book, I went to HBO and said, I want to make a film. I actually suggested a film series, but they were like, forget the series, but you can do one of the films, and we like the one you proposed on eating disorders. And so then I started the film Thin.
So was that an interest of yours, or was it something, I mean, how did you?
Yeah, it was part of girl culture. So girl culture was about how the body had become kind of the primary expression of identity for right. girls and women. And eating disorders were a piece of that story. And so then I went in deep and got access to a clinic after a couple years of kind of development, and then we ended up making the whole film in this residential clinic for women.
So was that, I mean, I was there for the first screenings at Sundance, and the line around the block of women in the snow waiting for the movie, and then you did not get big distribution, at least for that picture, did not get a big theatrical. And I think everybody was anticipating that this would be kind of a breakthrough film, and that there was an audience of women who don't normally go to the movies are going to go to see this movie. And then, I mean, it ended up HBO, and that's all great, but it was like, there was a sense that it was going to be like, that was the point where documentaries were doing big business, and it didn't quite happen, and it felt like people were afraid of the subject.
You know, it was a little bit different from that, because HBO commissioned the film.
Right.
And so it was always for HBO, and at that time, I think HBO wasn't really doing theatrical at that time, but I think also even me and the producers, I mean, I didn't know anything about the film business at the time, but just instinctually, and I think the producers knew that it would be a hard sell to get people into the theaters to watch women with eating disorders. I mean, there are girls who purge in the film. It's a kind of portrait of suffering. It's a portrait of addiction. And unlike Queen of Versailles and Generation Wealth, that have a lot of entertaining elements, a lot of laughs, and drama, Thin is a hard film. I think I'm really proud of it because so many people in the eating disorder community have seen it. It's something that is still playing, and I think in the end, it really did reach its audience through HBO, and there was an educational program that went with it. And I feel like in the eating disorder community, it got like just complete saturation. So it was a success, but it wasn't like a commercial movie kind of, but we did get nominated for an Emmy.
I just feel like every teenage girl should see this movie. Like in their, like in eighth grade or whatever, they should show it to every kid. Because it's so, I mean, it is such a powerful and such a, it is as gritty as anything, as tough as anything to watch. But when you watch it, it changes your perspective, I think, on the whole thing.
Well, thank you. I think what we tried to do was kind of take the glamour or sensationalism out of a disease which people think of as a rich girl disease or a model disease, and really show that, first of all, it's equal opportunity for girls in America. And second of all, it's really a mental illness that's just so hard to recover from. And I think it really had an influence on me because I really learned about addiction and rehab in that film. And I think that ended up being a big part of the Generation Wealth story.
Yeah. Well, the Rizzo in that movie, having to eat that cupcake, is still one of the most compelling scenes I think ever put on film. Narrative or documentary or whatever, it haunts me still every day. I think of it a little bit at some point.
That's amazing.
While I'm watching somebody try to eat a cupcake or thinking about it. Anyway, I mean, it's an interesting dichotomy, though, because, as you say, that was kind of the stripped-down view of the world, and yet you were famous for the kind of this dark view, but a very pretty view of glam in a weird way. It's an interesting dichotomy. Was that line weird for you?
Well, I feel like there's always been a lot of black humor and comic elements in my work. In a way, it's kind of like the serious side of the superficial or kind of looking for meaning in the things that we often think of as light. And so, in a way, Queen of Versailles was the first film where I was kind of able to bring the sensibility of my photography, which mixed kind of comedy and sociology and seriousness, into that film. You know, Thin was my first film, and in a way, the style is quite different from my photographic work, even though, like, the intimacy and the access is similar. But Queen of Versailles, I think, brought those more visual elements, camp elements, tension between comedy and tragedy.
Mm. Have you? Are you surprised that people give you as much access as they give you?
I mean, I'm grateful for it. I couldn't do anything without the kind of kindness and generosity of strangers. Like, really, the access that I'm given is such a gift. It's the only thing that makes the work possible. And I mean, I think access is a weird thing. It seems so impossible before you get it, and then once you have it, mm-hmm. it's kind of like a best friend. It just feels like you always had it, and then of course you can lose it just as easily. I mean, I think establishing trust is 90% of what I do, and then once you're able to take pictures or make or shoot film through a camera, that's like the icing on the cake, but that's you got to get there first.
So when you shoot this stuff, like, for instance, the girl in this movie, Generation Wealth, who was the best body in the Beverly Hills High and now is kind of semi-reclusive, it seems, in the up in the hills somewhere. I mean, was a lot of that conversation had before you then went and shot? Or did you kind of know where that was
going? Well, Mijanu is a great example of somebody that I have had a relationship with for so long and was so happy that she trusted me to tell her story again. I mean, when I met her, she was in high school. She was at Beverly Hills High, best physique at Beverly High. I followed her for a while, but I made a picture of her that became probably my most iconic picture. It's on the cover of my first book. It was published all around the world, and it was kind of like this candy-coated, like, American dream, kind of, or American graffiti almost, picture of these beautiful young people in these cars and fancy cars and materialism against the beach. And Mijanu didn't want to be defined by that. She really made an effort to kind of get as far away from that world of image and the superficial as possible. And so when we had stayed in touch personally. I went to her wedding, and we had always stayed in touch, but she had gone down a very different path. She had met the Dalai Lama. She had become very spiritual. Mm-hmm. She had moved to the country, was raising her daughter without television. And so, we had a conversation about it before, because she wasn't trying to come into the limelight in any way. Mm-hmm. But I felt like her trajectory was really important. And in a way, I think her story at the end and the stories of a lot of the subjects that I knew back in the 90s at the end kind of provide the hope for the film, because in a way they've gone through these difficult journeys, but they've made conscious choices about how they wanted to live out of that. And so
a lot about the next generation.
Yeah. And so I was so happy when I was able to film with her again.
So when did you decide that you would be part of this film? And your family?
Yeah.
Much to their chagrin at times, it seems.
That was an evolution. In fact, a lot of the footage of me for the film, when we shot it, we didn't know it was going to be for the film. The conscious part was the interviews that I did with my mom, my dad, and my kids. And I started that more as a way to look at the perspective of their generation from people that I was connected to, but not thinking it was going to be about our relationship or me or our personal lives. And it just kind of evolved. I think that it was such a journey for me over these 25 years. I felt like the different people that I had met along the way and their arcs were so compelling in understanding what had happened in this generation. And in a way, it was my journey that connected them. So I felt like I had to be kind of the connective tissue in making the whole story make sense and say what I wanted to say. But I started out more as a narrator. But my work is always very intimate, and my interviews are very intimate and probing. And that ended up being the same when I interviewed members of my own family. And I think my son kind of kicked it off when he really challenged me and kind of implicated me in a way for also being part of the addiction that I document in other people. And in my case, I realized that my work was a kind of addiction. And so, yeah, that kind of transformed the film and made it so I needed to be a bigger part of it. And I think, I mean, ultimately, I felt like it was important to include both because I had been so, my subjects had been so honest and vulnerable with me that when my story became relevant to the story, I felt like I had to be brave enough to include it. And also, I mean, part of what I felt with this work is that we are all complicit. You know, I've always documented from the inside, you know, having, in this film, I tried to show how I had different desires at different ages that made me empathic with the subjects that I filmed. And so I felt like including me helped make that point that none of us are outside of generation wealth.
So is that a progression for you, or is that just the circumstances of the film as you were making it?
I'm never doing that again, I don't think. I mean, it's really different for me. Usually I'm more of a reportage cinema verite. And I felt like in this film was like meta in so many ways. It was about the process. It was about images. It was about how our culture had become obsessed with images. You know, my kids are saying, I'm complaining about me filming them all the time, and then they're in the film. And so it was just, I think there was something about looking back over 25 years, considering kind of the work as evidence of this change in our culture, that in a way it just wrapped up everything and wanted to kind of work on different levels.
So does it mean another story from Lauren Greenfield that we haven't seen before? Is this the end of something or the beginning of something?
Yeah, I feel like it is the end of something. I feel like it was very cathartic for me to bring this to completion. It's also a little bit the end of the primacy of print. I mean, all of my films so far and a lot of the work that we see in the film came from me shooting on assignment for magazines. A lot of the people I met through magazines. And print being kind of the thing that everybody looked at and was kind of influent, had impact in the world. And I feel like that's changed. I'm not working as much on assignment for magazines. There's not the same kind of funding in magazines. And people aren't opening the Sunday magazine and like learning about the world in the same way. And so my methods have changed too. And so I feel like it closes that chapter a little bit. I scan more than 10,000 pictures for this project. I felt like I needed to kind of archive it and make this history. I went through more than 500,000 pictures with a curator, Trudy Wilnerstack. And I also feel like I kind of left nothing on the field. I really worked as hard as I can and kind of did my best with the film and with the book, and now I do feel kind of liberated to move on to something else.
So what do you think the future of image is? I mean, everything can't be a selfie in a movie or a video.
Well, I mean, in the movie, we also see kind of social media and Instagram and how that works for my son's generation. I mean, I think photography has become more democratic. Everybody's making their own images. There's an excitement to that too. I mean, it's not the same. It's not the same as a kind of telling a whole story in one image. I think I'll continue to do that, but the means of production have changed. They're not really there anymore. And
I'm sure that closet back at National Geographic is an archive now. Yeah. Material's gone by.
Yeah, everything's digital. And in the movie, you kind of see that progression from analog to digital. I mean, I think, you know, as we see in the film, there's consequences to everything. And there's a loss, I think we remember the still image in a way that we don't remember film. But I was really drawn to film from the beginning, and Generation Wealth is no exception, because of its emotional potential and emotional impact. And I feel like there's something about the still photograph that is slightly voyeuristic. And I feel like in film, you're able to kind of stand in somebody's shoes more and empathize more. Mm-hmm. And I hope that is what happens with the subjects in Generation Wealth.
I think with a still, you or any image really, in some ways, an oil painting or whatever, there's a part of it is the audience, the viewer, deciding what to look at and how long to look at it and to look in the details and everything else. Whereas in film or television, I mean, the editing is really it tells you where to go.
Yes.
All the time.
Yeah.
Almost never for longer than 3 or 4 seconds. So it's a very, the idea of not having that, the chance to let it breathe is kind
yeah.
of horrifying.
There's a lot of like meat on the bone in this movie. I feel like there's, it's very dense, and it's almost like there's a lot there. You could watch it more than once and see different things. And I think that the book has a different feel. It has more characters, and it's organized by chapters. And you can't appreciate the still photographs in the film in the same way, because like you said, yeah. they go pretty fast. But you go on a more experiential, emotional journey. And if people want to see the pictures, they can go to the library and see the book.
So have you experimented with shooting like selfies or shot, or faster, quicker, not so careful?
I mean, yeah, and this movie is part of that. Like some of the scenes, like I said, the personal stuff in the film, well, most of it when we shot it, we did not intend for it to be part of the film. And I think that was one of the things that, one of the reasons Frank did not want me to be in the film for a long time is that I try to be really, really authentic in my work. And when you turn the camera on yourself, there's a quality of self-consciousness. And mm-hmm. so we really didn't plan any of the shooting of ourselves. But we started shooting more just on our phones and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then when things were interesting or relevant, gave it to the editor to consider. And mm-hmm. so it wasn't, you know, a kind of self-conscious part of the movie construction.
Right.
But what ended up being some of the most important scenes, like when Frank grabs my phone and mm-hmm. turns it on me, are shot with a camera, which is really funny and a little bit liberating for me, because I'm somebody that cares so much about the image. The film is 4K. Mm-hmm. I, you know, care about the lighting and the composition. But I think that there's something that loosens me up as a documentarian by that technology, in the same way that people like D.A. Pennybaker got loosened up by cameras getting small, or the 35 millimeter camera, or when I started working on digital, I was loosened up by the fact that we didn't have to have the perfect exposure. You could just really just shoot, and it was much more reparable than when you shot Kodachrome. So that was exciting. I mean, this film is a complete mix of DSLR footage I shot by myself, footage I shot with a crew for the film, iPhone footage, pictures, tapes that I never intended to be part of a movie. I mean, it has that kind of collage feel, I think, in the media.
Yeah, this package has gotten, which is not anywhere comparable to the quality of your work, but is gotten tinier and tinier and tinier and tinier. For me, it was about travel and the simplicity of setting up and all that stuff. But it's amazing how it's changed just, you know, year to year.
Well, it changes what you can get. I mean, I felt so strongly like that when I started making film. I was really worried that I couldn't get the moments that I got in photography, because you needed more people and you needed more planning, and every day was more expensive than it was just me with a camera. And so we gained something and we lost something. And I feel like with the technology now, you know, first of all, with the digital cameras that allow you to basically shoot in the dark. I mean, there's nightclub footage in this film that, you know, you're seeing more than you could see with your eye there. It's unbelievable. And then it also allows you, you know, the intimacy of being at the dinner table with your family and have your kids complain about you and catching it without kind of self-consciousness.
had 100 lights as well.
We couldn't have got it if there had been a crew there. It just wouldn't have, it would have been weird.
So do you take a lot of photos with your phone, personally?
Yeah, yeah, now I do, because also I like the lightness. I don't like the weight. Of course, then when I get my real camera, my Canon with my flash, I find that I am able to take much better pictures. Mm-hmm. But there's a diaristic quality to the phone that I like, and also just having it with me at all times.
So your mother is kind of the adult voice. Your parents are, but your mother ends up being a little dominant in that regard, which probably is true in real life as well, based on that interview. Was that a consideration? I mean, did you consider going to the parents of other characters in the movie, or did
Well, a lot. Yeah, I mean, when we came up with the title Generation Wealth, it was really when I started making the film. It wasn't the title of the book originally. And I thought of it as a generation. But it grew into its title in that the movie really became about parenting and about what's passed on generationally. And so a lot of the main subjects in the film, we meet their children.
Right.
And so with other people, it was more the children than the parents. With me, it was my children and my parents. But I mean, my parents were really important to the story in terms of the values they gave me, but then how I didn't really want those values. I wanted the values of the kids at school. And so thinking about the way those two things conflicted was, in a way, the source of the beginning of this work. And I mean, it ended up getting more complicated than that, because in each person's story, we see that their addiction comes from a kind of trauma or emptiness that they're trying to fill with either money or search for beauty or youth or fame or whatever it is. And that made me start to think about my own relationship to work as an addiction and what was driving that. And that caused me to kind of challenge my mom about where my insecurity came from. And in a way, a lot of the movie is about insecurity, and I was terribly insecure as a teenager. And so I started to push on where that came from. And so that made the interaction with my mom not just about what wealth meant in her generation, but also about our relationship. And it was kind of prompted by the conversations with Noah, who challenged me.
And were you expecting it to go there when you sat down with her? Did you kind of know where you were going, or?
No, we covered a lot of different things. And actually, in the edit, we tried a lot of different things. But I think, in a way, that was the kind of spontaneous verite moments that are really why I make documentaries. Like in Queen of Versailles, when they get hit by the crash, and they were the family I never thought would be hit by the crash. Mm. And the way that brings out who they really were and what the story really was, I felt like similarly the things that came out with my mom and with Noah, even though in the beginning I didn't know if they would be relevant, as the film progressed, I understood that those were the kind of, that was in a way the emotional truth of the film.
It's funny because I didn't think about it till this very second, but you're in a lot of your work, in your film work, that the moments of deflection are the moments that are the most telling.
Yeah.
It's not what people say. It's what it's that moment of waiting for them to try to figure out what to say. That's where you learn who they really are.
And I always try to get those, you know, in between moments. It's funny because We had very little behind the scenes footage of me shooting because I just never cover that. But we found a couple pieces here and there. And one of the funny things was I had been filming with Future the rapper, and I was waiting for like 30 minutes to get this shot of him coming out of his house in Beverly Hills and going through the guard gates. And basically, I couldn't wait any longer, and I went to find out what was happening. And in that moment, he came up, and I ruined the shot. And I said, shit, fuck. And then, you know, that was that. And my assistant, Carrie, was also kind of part of how we got this mix-up. Anyway, that off moment of shit fuck ended up in this movie. And when we watched it for the first time, Carrie, like, looked at me like, she couldn't believe it, because that was, like, our mutual screw up, and then that ended up making the cut. And Future didn't even end up in the film. And so it was, yeah, I think it's like those, sometimes it's those off moments that are the most revelatory. And I think in a way that's why it takes a long time to cut a documentary. This film was kind of a mammoth edit. We spent 30 months editing the film. And, you know, I think it's like you don't really know. It finds itself. We really found it in the edit room. And it's like peeling back the layers, looking for what is that emotional and dramatic truth that you need to tell.
Some films you need 30 months. It's interesting because I do a lot of these interviews and we have these conversations, and it's like, it's very clear. Some films, like some documentaries even, are pretty dead on. They know where they're going, and, you know, obviously they're details, but they kind of know where it's going. And some films really find themselves after a year of suffering and not being able to figure out what the movie even is.
Well,
and then all of a sudden, boom, it shows up somehow.
This was a little bit different in the sense that the film was being made while we were editing it. So a lot of the footage that I shot, the personal footage, what happened in the middle of the edit. And I think it's because I was contemplating these issues, and then as I saw them percolating in my own life, would try to capture it. And so, and also the characters and their development, and Trump becoming president. And Trump is a kind of character in the film as well. And so,
you're subtle.
Subtle.
General, you're very generous.
He's there more in spirit than in, but I think we feel him throughout. And so these were things that were happening in real time. And so in a way, the edit room was kind of a live creative bed for making the story.
And so how do you feel about your work as it goes out into the world at this point? Are you relaxed about it? Are you anticipating opening weekends or those book sales or how many people are coming to a show? I mean, or is it kind of like, I do the work, I'm done the work, it'll be what it's going to be?
I mean, I feel like you kind of have to be what it's going to be. I remember there was this museum curator who was talking to a class of aspiring photographers, and he said, if you are thinking, and I think the class was called How to Have Your Picture on the Wall of a Museum, and he said, if you are thinking about how to get your picture on the wall of a museum, you can just forget about it because it's never going to happen. You just need to be completely 24/7 thinking about that picture, just making the pictures, thinking about that picture. And then maybe someday, either before or after your death, your pictures will be in a museum. And I feel like, you know, this is, I think one thing you see in the film is it is kind of an existential process where a lot of times you're following your intuition, working as hard as you can without knowing if you'll ever reach where you're trying to reach or if you'll ever do something that works or that people understand. And I feel like I tried my hardest on this, and I it was very cathartic. I'm really proud of the film, but you know, now we just have to launch the baby in the world and
but
let
you
it happen.
Yourself have become a known figure. You're famous for this, for the works that you've done. You are, you know, there's an expectation and there's an anticipation when your name is on something. Does that change it for you, or have you not accepted that yet?
I mean, listen, a documentary in the theaters is always a challenge. I was so excited to get to have The Queen of Versailles in the theaters. I love the theatrical experience. With this film, it really works as a communal experience. It's 100% better in the theater where you hear people laughing, you hear people crying. I hope people watch it in the theater. But, you know, you never know what will be a commercial success. And so I hope it finds its audience.
And did the embrace of Queen change anything for you, or was that just nice?
I think it, you know, it's really hard to make documentaries and to work as a photographer and to get to do your art. I feel like it's a great privilege. And Queen of Versailles definitely helped me make the next movie. You know, I feel like each kind of thing that you put out in the world and people get, it allows you to make the next thing. So it definitely, I think, increased the trust that I was able to get in making this film. And this is an unusual film. We didn't really have a model for this film. It's part essay, part personal film, part character driven. It did take a lot of trust, I think, for the people that, for Amazon Studios who commissioned the film. So I'm really grateful for that.
When I get, as I recall, the third act of Queen of Versailles was also somewhat unexpected while you were making the movie. You didn't really see that coming.
Definitely.
So that changed that movie as you went as well.
Definitely. And I mean, that's what I've always loved in the photography. It's like Cartier-Bresson's decisive moment. That moment, which you can't predict, but which brings the whole story together.
So, do you anticipate ever stopping? Are you going to, I mean, is this like, is it something magically will come to you as the next thing and you'll start doing that?
I'm actually already working on another film that I started before this film, and also has a kind of unexpected elements that happened along the way. I feel like, on the other hand, I did learn something in this process and also had my own realizations and awakening along with the subjects of this film, and I'm also trying to moderate with a tiny bit of balance. I've never been good at balance. I still love my work, but I'm also just trying to remind myself that you don't get that time back with your kids, and I need to grab onto that too when I have the chance.
So you're really a filmmaker now as much as you are a photographer.
Yeah, I mean, I still do photography with my films, but definitely the driving kind of force behind the research and the ideas and the creative process is now the films rather than photography.
And is the range of the world interesting to you again? I mean, when you talked about in the movie when you started at Nat Geo and you did the project in, I think it was in Africa.
In Mexico.
In Mexico, and it didn't work out. Does breaking out of this world that you've now been in for a while intriguing?
You know, I actually prefer to kind of go deeper into what I already know, to kind of take a deeper cut or a different cut into work that I've, into ideas that I've already explored, because I feel like it gives me an ability to kind of see see from a place of more understanding and experience. My new film is actually takes place in Asia, but so it's not so much the place it is, but I feel like I learned at the beginning of my career that chasing the exotic was not the way to do the most insightful work, that I really needed to lean in on what I knew and where I came from and try to make work that I could relate to, and hopefully others could too because of that.
So what's the best compliment somebody can give you when they've seen one of your films or gone to one of your shows?
I mean, with this film, like with The Queen of Versailles, the best compliment I've gotten is it made me think about my own relationship to money and materialism, my own generation wealth, how I'm also complicit. I mean, I think it's an activating film. It does make you kind of think about a lot of different things. There are a lot of different kinds of people in it, so I feel like everybody will relate to somebody. And yeah, that's the greatest compliment, when somebody said it made me think about what I took for granted. Because I think, for me, the work's really about deconstructing the culture that we live in and seeing the matrix that affects us on a daily basis.
I think it does that pretty well.
Thank you.
It is a fascinating mixture of people and suffering and joy. But you know, I feel like I drove the guy who was the three guys in the car with the.
Yeah.
I feel like the last night, actually driving home, there was a guy in a Bentley with a cigarette out of his arm hanging outside of the car and kind of weaving a little bit. I was thinking, when I just looked at the film again, I was like, that guy, I know that guy. That's the guy from the movie. He just has got a bigger car this time. He just wants a bigger and bigger car. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for doing this.
Happy to.